Andy Breckman, welcome back to the David Feldman Show. Congratulations on being asked back.
Name some other friends or guests that have been asked back.
Everybody's been asked back. You're the only one stupid
who's accepted.
Enough. Yeah, and you're chewing gum.
I'm going to take the gum out.
That's okay.
No. That's how much I respect you. The gum is going under the table.
Okay.
You can get it later. You can grab it later.
Well, let's start off with your toy company, Uncle Andy's Toys.
Okay. Uncle Andy, singular, toys. Yes. I have a company called Uncle Andy Toys, and I have a radio show that I do on WFMU called 7 Second Delay,
mm-hmm.
and I have a production company. Do you have one, a loan-out company?
No.
I have a loan-out company called Andy Breckman Productions, and here's what's interesting. I don't like any of those names. I had better names in mind, and I went with, I don't know why, it's just one of my regrets. I don't have a lot of regrets in my life.
Well, you have two game shows that you've sold to TBS.
I have one game show.
Shit happens.
Well, they bought a card game, a party game of mine, called Shit Happens. TBS bought the rights to Shit Happens. I was just sort of learning the ropes. They taught me the game show ropes. And TBS put it together and then changed the name, probably wisely.
To the Misery Index.
To the Misery Index. So,
and when can we see it on TBS?
It'll be on TBS this summer, next summer, maybe in the fall. I don't know.
This summer of 2019.
It's already been filmed. They're editing it. I'm proud of it.
That's amazing.
Yeah. I don't have a lot to do with it. I'm more of a consultant. It's kind of sweet. I don't have a lot of homework.
You also?
I just get to hang by the craft service table, flirt with the young interns. It's a perfect gig.
The Good Cop, starring Tony Danza on Netflix.
Yeah, that was on last year. That was a limited series. I didn't know at the time it was limited. They told me after the first season it was a limited series. It was a comedy mystery series.
With Josh Groban and Tony
Danza. Josh Groban and Tony Danza, yeah.
How did they get along?
I was proud of that.
A lot of infighting, a lot of jealousy.
My partners and I were very careful about hiring mensches, about not bringing in people with issues or baggage. That was sort of our main criteria. I'm just getting too old for that crap. So,
is anybody difficult to work with these days?
Well, is anybody difficult to work with these days?
I don't know. We can't be anymore.
That's true. I guess that's true. Maybe are people? Do you find people are more
terrified,
careful?
I think even before the Me Too accusation started, corporate America did a pretty good job of telling everybody they could be replaced.
Yeah, I guess I don't know if I would agree. I'll agree just because.
Without naming names.
Time is short. Okay. Without naming names.
Did you ever work with somebody who was difficult?
Oh, my goodness.
In what way difficult? Don't mention names.
Okay. Well, I'll just use a first name. So that Whoopi. But you don't know which Whoopi I'm talking about.
No, I don't.
Goldberg. It's Goldberg.
Okay. She wasn't difficult.
She was pretty difficult.
Really? Like in what way? Well, what movie? Hot to Trot?
No, I don't know. She was. I worked on a big ensemble movie years ago.
Rat Race.
Yeah. And she was one of the guys. So she came in. She was probably the biggest star in the group. One of the biggest stars in the group. She had an Academy Award, yeah.
In what way was she difficult?
Well, she came in with a lot of preconditions. She would only work until 5 o'clock, so you had to shoot around her. She would show up when she showed up.
And why does somebody do that? Is that a power game?
I don't know. I once backed my car out of the driveway too fast and scraped my neighbor's car. And I went, I stopped what I was doing. I got out of my car. I went inside my house, got my checkbook, went running across the street to the neighbors and said, let me just give you money now. I just didn't want there to be anything in the air between us, mm-hmm. any tension, any stress. When I see you, I just want to be happy to see you. I want you to be happy to see me. That's just who I am. Mm-hmm. I just can't stand owing people or having a grudge. I'm not good at it. So I don't know why people don't just bend over backwards in work situations. I'm always surprised when I see people that don't mind stressing other people out or imposing themselves on other people. I'm always surprised, aren't you?
What is the thinking, or is there no thinking? Because in terms of business, if you're impossible to work with, eventually nobody wants to work with you. So why?
Is that true? I guess that's true. If you're difficult, well, I guess you reach a point where you have a sense of job security. I don't know. You know, if you're a star,
I have enough money. I want to quit. I'm going to keep putting things up in front of me. Bad scenes. So
yeah,
people...
I don't know. There is. When I worked at Saturday Night Live, Eddie Murphy was the biggest, literally the biggest movie star in the world. There was a year or two where he had like two or three huge mega hits in a row. But he agreed, I don't know why, but he agreed to do it one more half a season of Saturday Night Live, his last half a season. He must have been 20 years old. He was 20, he was a kid. Anyway, he would keep us waiting for hours. He would just keep us waiting. It was some kind of power thing. It must have brought him some kind of pleasure to know there were 50 people waiting to start read through. I don't know. It must have just been...
Well, I briefly worked for Lorne Michaels on there was the first meeting. The entire crew was assembled. He showed up 3 hours late, and I thought, I get it.
You do?
Oh, I got it, yeah. I'm in charge, and if anybody's going to be a prima donna or raise an objection, leave now.
But why do you have to assert yourself? Who didn't know he was in charge? Maybe it's like carrying a concealed weapon. Like, you know, I could, like, you just sit there like, I could kill everybody here if I wanted to. It just must be this power, this buzz. I could pull out a gun if I wanted to.
You've worked for everybody. So let's start at the beginning. Was your first job Letterman or first job Saturday Night Live?
My first job, I started out as a performer. Is that what you did? You started out stand up?
I'm asking the questions.
Like David Feldman, I started out, and Whoopi, I think, started out as a performer. I used to do funny songs.
And you had a feud with Don McLean. You're the only person.
I had I had a celebrity feud. Do you have a celebrity feud?
I have one with your son.
Yeah, that's hardly, not quite on the radar. Mine wasn't quite on the radar either. It was a celebrity feud that no one cared about but
is
us.
Is it like Fred Allen?
Yes.
It was
a real feud.
Fred Allen and Jack Benny, or Matt Damon and Jimmy Kimmel.
Yes, but there's a difference. In our case, no one cares.
No one cares.
No one knew or cared.
Is it real?
Yeah, it was not put on. Why would we go to the trouble of, why would I go to the trouble of putting on a feud with Don McLean?
But who would feud with Don McLean? Starry Night and American Pie?
I didn't know he was a singer until after this started.
Seriously?
No, I'm kidding.
what happened?
Well, I used to tour with him. I would open for him.
So when? Before?
Well, we had the same manager.
Was this
ago.
Before or after American Pie?
Oh, this is after American Pie. He was living off American Pie. He was a big star. And I would open for him. So we traveled around together. And, you know, it was him and me. We were folky, so it wasn't like a band or anything.
Were you doing comedy?
Yeah, I was doing funny songs. Just as an aside, what I would sometimes do is I would come out, and in the middle of my set, I would sing American Pie.
Really?
Yeah. and then I would say, gee, I hope Don hadn't planned on doing that one.
Did he think that was funny?
For a while he did. For a while he did. And then there was one night when he just snapped at me after the show.
About it's it. Don McLean. How can he snap?
He's famous for his temper.
Don McLean?
Don McLean has anger management issues. I don't think it's even a secret. He just lost recently. He went through a horrible divorce. His wife accused him of terrible things, physical, you know, assault. He was accused, you know, his wife accused him of assault, and he went through a horrible divorce, very public divorce, and he just actually, I believe UCLA just withdrew a Lifetime Achievement Award.
Because of
he's been Me Too'd, but it's no, it didn't surprise me.
I'll tell you something. It sounds like you really don't like him.
Well, no, I don't think about him very much, but except for this, we were on tour. He really is a difficult guy, not a nice guy. You know, nobody. He doesn't have a lot of friends. He just had trouble. He had his issues. Then years later, I was working for this radio station, and they had a little publication. They were putting out a magazine. This is before the internet. And they asked me to write an article or two. And I wrote an article about my experiences with Don McLean. And I wrote it for this magazine, and it was published in this little, it's like a newsletter, and it disappeared. Then, 10 years later, the internet kicks in. Everything bubbles up. Mm-hmm. Everything you ever wrote bubbles up. So this article I wrote about Don McLean bubbles up. So somebody sent it to Don McLean. It had been off his radar for 10 years. I had forgotten about it. I had moved on. So he does the worst thing you could do. What's the worst thing from a PR point of view you could do?
Respond to
exactly.
It.
He responds to me. Who am I? Some schlub. Who am I? He responds to me in the funniest. You can get it online. You can find it online. It's my letter, then his response. Don McLean. If you Google my last name Breckman and then McLean and then Celebrity Feud, and you'll see both letters. And he calls me some you know, idiot doofus. He had some kind of name for it, like Trump has nicknames. He had a nickname for me.
I thought this was a put on.
Oh no! This was very real. I not only have had this Celebrity Feud, but I know I've won the Celebrity Feud. Here's how I know I won. 3 years ago. He's going through a horrible divorce, or maybe 2 years ago, even less. Going through a horrible divorce. Who calls me?
His wife.
His wife. This is when you know you win a Celebrity Feud. If you're ever wondering, how do you know who wins these feuds? Does anyone ever win? You're probably wondering. So his wife calls me, and that article I wrote in that newsletter some 20 years ago, she wants to use it in her court case. Against Don McLean.
You were going to be a lack of character.
I was going to be a character witness. She wanted to submit it as an exhibit in this court case and needed my permission and was asked. And I said, sure, you can use it in your court case. It's already been published. And then she said this. And she said, do you have any other stories about my soon-to-be ex-husband that I could use in court? Okay? And so I had, and I did have a couple of things I can remember. He wasn't 100% faithful to his wife.
Wow, I've never heard you talk.
Well, I'm not bitter, but anyway. But here's an interesting thing. I said I don't think I want to go there, even though because I've been through a divorce. I think you can relate to this as well. He was down. He was so far down. He was just in the worst place probably he's ever been in his life. I just didn't want to stand over him and kick him. You know, he's having the. I win this Celebrity Feud. I'm satisfied with that, but I don't want to pour any more fuel onto that fire. So I said I'd rather not be deposed and add any more to it.
But it's important to be nice to people on your way up and on your way down. For example, you wrote a movie starring Walter Matthau, Meg Ryan, and it was called IQ.
Yeah. Yeah.
A young actor named Tony Shalhoub was in it.
Yeah.
Did you get along with Tony Shalhoub?
I have no memory of meeting him on the set.
But you cast him as Monk.
I did, well, USA and I, years later. But at the time, I didn't remember he had been in IQ. I was one of eight writers on IQ. I was the first writer, and then it had been rewritten a number of times. And I ended up on the set. They brought me back to the set. It came kind of back around to me.
But you're listed as the writer.
I think I share writing credit with someone on that.
Why does that happen? You've written so many movies and you're
when you write a movie for a studio movie, you don't own the script. You literally give away the rights to the script. They can change it. They can change the gender of the lead. They can reset it in.
They can change the gender of the writer.
They can change the gender. They can swap out writers, and they do. You have no say at all. When you write a play, you retain the copyright, and it's yours. When you write a novel, the copyright's in your name. A script is not in your name. Paramount Pictures, in that case, own the script.
There's no way you can write a script unless
independent. People go into directing and independent movies. If you're a producer and in a smaller movie, you can insist contractually that no changes be made. I suppose, or if you have enough juice as a writer.
But if you're a newbie,
if you're a young kid, fresh
out of NYU film school, you get a script accepted by Paramount, they are immediately going to pay you and then turn it over to somebody else.
They could, or they have the right to do that.
Have they ever done that?
I've had all sorts of experiences, and some I work closely with the director, and I love the experience, and some, you know, IQ is an example. I went to see the finished product of IQ. There was one exchange, two lines, that I recognized as mine. Two lines by the time it was done.
So what do you take pride in, if you're, not you, but just in general, if you're a movie writer?
Well, the fact is the sweetest dream that labor knows, as Robert Frost says. You have to love the process. You have to love writing. And it has to bring you satisfaction when you're in that position, when you're starting out. Because it's going to be either not sold or altered beyond recognition.
Right, but you can identify a move or a plot point of yours if you've...
Yep, I guess I was proud. I was very proud of the... I'm very proud of my titles. And IQ was a good title. And I'm proud of that. The setting was... You know, I'll tell you how IQ came about. When I was at Saturday Night Live, the guest host, you know, obviously every week there was a new guest host, would come in on Mondays. And we would all gather in Lorne Michaels' office, and Lorne Michaels would always ask the same question to the guest host. Is there any character that you've never played in your career that you've always wanted to play? Mm-hmm. You know, we could, maybe that would be fun for while you're here for you to play a character you've always wanted to play. Because we can accommodate you with a sketch, you know, we put a couple writers on it. And more than a few people, Bill Murray, Robin Williams, a few actors that came through during my tenure, said Albert Einstein. Hmm. I've always wanted to play Albert Einstein. So I was an ambitious kid, and I was thinking about what I should do for my next movie. And I thought, well, if I write a movie about Albert Einstein, it seems like there might be some actors that would respond to that. You know, that was kind of the genesis. Also, I was so tired of writing movies set in New Jersey, which I always did. I lived in New Jersey, and having them filmed in Canada or L.A. I wanted a movie that if they made it, and the odds are always, it's always a long shot whether a movie's made, if they made it, it would have to be set in New Jersey. That was the genesis of IQ. You know, it had to be Princeton.
And Albert Einstein. And
Albert Einstein in Princeton, 1955. And they did. They shot it in Princeton. And because you want to go to the set, you want to eat from the craft foods, you want to flirt with the interns.
What is it about Albert Einstein?
I'll tell you another thing about Albert Einstein. He was very funny.
Mm-hmm. He
told jokes, and he was genuinely funny. Here's an Albert Einstein quote. Somebody came up to him and said, "I'd like to shake the hand that wrote the theory of relativity." And Albert Einstein said, "I wouldn't be too quick. It's done other things too."
That's
Isn't
great.
That a great joke?
Yeah.
That's Albert Einstein.
What do you think Albert Einstein would have been like in a writing room?
What do you think Albert Einstein would have been like in a writer's room?
I don't know.
Tell me if you have this experience. A lot of writers I've worked with were mathematically inclined. They mm-hmm. were either lawyers
and musicians.
Musicians. They were or they've gone to law school. Some of them musicians. A lot of them are problem solvers. Because comedy writing at its heart is problem solving. It's very mathematical in a way. What we're doing in our writer's room this week is very mathematical. You write a sketch, you have to know mm-hmm. the sequence of things, what information to divulge and when to divulge it. It's very much like solving a mathematical problem. So Albert Einstein probably would have enjoyed the process. He might have told that "it's done other things too" joke more than once, because as far as I can tell, that was the funniest thing he ever said.
Do you think Mel Brooks, Woody Allen, and Neil Simon, had there been a twitch in time, could they have been destroyed by a showrunner?
Could they have been destroyed?
Could have gotten a job in the 50s and just been so abused, he went
that he
to
would get out of the business?
Yeah.
I'm getting out of the business? I think Woody Allen is... wait, is that our time up?
No.
Oh, it's not? Oh, damn.
Damn.
Are you sure? Look again. Well, it's a good question. You might be asking... Are you asking this question? Was Woody Allen, Mel Brooks, and Neil Simon, the triumvirate, among my heroes, were they so talented that no matter what was thrown at them and what setbacks they had, they would have risen to the top? Does talent always...
I think in
Rise
their case, yes. I think they were indefatigable. I don't think you could defeat Mel Brooks.
Yes, I would agree. I think all three of them would have survived any bumps in the road and probably did, any setbacks. I believe greatness is recognized. If you're great, I don't think you have anything to worry about.
And
if you're good, like me, then you've got to work hard, and it's a lot of luck involved and timing, and you have to network and be shrewd about career moves. But really, really great writing, like great joke writing. I think, do you agree that there's really no one that is writing great jokes that is not recognized?
Yeah, I think you have to be recognized in the right context. For example, I don't think Woody Allen would be good around a table with eight other writers. I don't think Neil Simon would be good. I think Neil Simon used to whisper in Carl Reiner's ear.
Yeah, well, I heard that. That came from, that was, he said that, Neil Simon. But I don't know how true that is. That might just be
self-effacing.
Well,
there are certain guys, like I would think Mel Brooks would not be as good on paper as he would be in the room.
You can dig up, if you dig deeply enough, old sketches of Woody Allen's that he wrote back when he was a kid in those shows.
What are the different talents you need to be a comedy writer? Because some guys are great in the room but bad on the page. Some guys are great with dialogue but not great with story.
If you're strong in either, I know some guys that are great pitchers. They can sell an idea, but then they can't execute it. They always disappoint you when they execute it. They're probably a lot of those. I mean, those guys, there used to be a lot more development money in Hollywood. People would spend more money just putting things in the pipeline. They would sell an idea. They would go to the movie studios or networks and sell an idea. But then on paper, it just never worked. You used to be able to point to big houses in L.A., big, big sprawling houses that you envied in L.A., and you would say, what did that guy do? What are his credits? Mm-hmm. And the answer sometimes was, well, nothing. He's never gotten anything made. But there was development money. He would sell things. He would sell ideas.
But when you're collaborating with somebody, there are different levels of talent. Like, you can have the macro idea
in the room.
Or in a collaboration.
Well, everybody's a package deal. Everybody has strengths, and I know I do, and weaknesses.
I mean, you can pitch a scene, a big idea for a scene, but you can't come up with the ligaments, but you can maybe come up with the jokes.
Right. Other people have a feel for the language and turning a phrase.
And do you hear the voices in your head?
Like Raymond Chandler. I love reading Raymond Chandler. You could open up any Raymond Chandler novel to any page and read it, and it's poetry. But the plots are horrible. He did that with just a blind spot of his.
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, his stories. He couldn't write a taut detective story.
The Big Sleep?
That was him. That was his breakthrough novel.
And the story really
makes
no sense.
The story just meandered, and it just wasn't as tight a thriller or mystery as others. You know, you can't compare it to James Cain, Double Indemnity, which to me was fat-free. You know, tight as a drum and perfectly balanced. But as a stylist, Raymond Chandler is one of my heroes.
You're a big detective.
That's another genre that I grew up loving, both genres.
Why?
Comedy and mystery writing.
Why mystery writing?
Well, I don't know. How do you know what the heart wants when you're 12 years old?
Are you always reading mysteries?
Not anymore. Not fiction anymore. But I'm grateful that I read it as a kid. I certainly put it to good use in my career. I was, I could come to the table with a mystery story with comedic elements, and not, that kind of was my edge. Not everybody else could do that.
Your favorite is Sherlock Holmes.
Sherlock what?
He fought Muhammad
That's
Ali.
That's a funny name. Sherlock. Now I'll Google that after we're done.
Who is your favorite? I read somewhere that it was Sherlock
Holmes. Sherlock Holmes. I read Arthur Conan Doyle, of course. I read, growing up, I read the John McDonald series. I read John Dixon Carr used to write Impossible Murders, Locked Room Murders.
Okay. Before you go, I'm going to ask you some desert island questions.
Okay. I once wrote a song when I was writing funny songs. It was called My Desperate Attempt. It was my desperate attempt to get listed in music critics' desert island lists when they make their list of what to bring. And the whole song was about how to build a raft. That was my song. It was I just wanted to be on that list.
SNL to David Letterman.
Yeah. No, Letterman to SNL. Yeah.
I started
at Letterman.
The very first.
Yeah, when he went up at NBC.
Was that your first writing job?
I had one credit before that on a kid's show.
How'd you get hired by Letterman?
I was performing at Folk City, the club that where the New York Times found Bob Dylan years ago, Folk City. I was performing there, and a critic from Variety happened to be in the audience and wrote a blurb about me and Variety. This is whoever that critic is. I wish I could remember his name. He changed my life. And the producers of this kid's show saw that review.
Of the kid's show?
The producer of the kid's show saw that review in Variety.
But how'd you get on Letterman?
Oh, Letterman? Good question. And there's a lesson here, too. My life is divided between lessons and cautionary tales. Some of my stories are lessons, and some of my stories are... After that kid's show, I got an agent from working on a kid's show. And I submitted 3 sketches to Saturday Night Live. Saturday Night Live passed. This was when they were in transition after the first 5-6 years. They passed, although Ann Beats wrote me a beautiful letter that I kept. So they passed. So anyway, I take a job in one of the first video stores in New York City. I'm a clerk in a video store. So unbeknownst to me, my agent took those same 3 sketches that SNL passed at and sent them to Meryl Marco, who I don't know if you know her.
She's been on the show countless times.
Oh, perfect. I owe her my life, as you're about to find out. Sent it to Meryl Marco, who was Letterman's girlfriend at the time, but also partner and head writer at the time.
And she kind of invented.
Had a lot to do with the tone of that show.
She was more than the girlfriend.
Yeah. She was partner, and head writer and co-creator. So this is unbeknownst to me. I was a fan of Letterman's. I knew his morning show. I knew him from his
So the late stand-up. Night show had not started.
No, the late night show was not started, and I didn't even know about it. And so I'm working at my video store, and the phone rings completely out of the blue, one of these phone calls that you just hope for in your life. And it was my agent, and my agent said, Meryl Marco and David Letterman are in town for one day. They're meeting writers. They'd like to meet you.
Wow.
Now. and I said, oh my goodness. And I got the kid out at the video store. I got him to cover my shift.
Right.
And I went racing uptown. They were at the Plaza. They had a suite in the Plaza. I went up, and Letterman was on a couch lying down. He didn't sit up. Meryl was very gracious and greeted me. And I sat in a chair, and I did have the chutzpah to do this. I do remember there was some change on the coffee table in front of Letterman, and I remember saying, "Can I have this?" and I just kind of swept it up, and I actually committed to the joke and put it in my pocket.
Great.
Yeah. So anyway, Meryl Marco and Letterman explained their ideas for the show, what they hoped to do, and she said, "To tell you the truth, the sketches you wrote for SNL, we enjoyed reading them, but." We can't, it's nothing. We're not a sketch show. We can't judge you by this. You know, if you want to, if you're so inclined, take a few weeks, take a month, write up a few pages based on our conversation today, and we'll see if there's, then we'll reconsider you. Mm-hmm. So this is what I did, and this is, I tell this story because if there are any young writers out there, it's a lesson to be learned. I went racing home. And I pulled an all-nighter. I just was up. I knew they were leaving for the airport in the morning. I knew that. They were here for one day. At the time, Letterman lived in Malibu. I don't know if this is when you knew him. He and Meryl lived in Malibu, and the show was going to be in Malibu. The show was going to be in L.A. But anyway, they were here for one day. So I had one night. I was determined to get material into their hands the next morning, and I pulled an all-nighter and went racing back up to the Plaza at dawn. And got it in her hands, got in the doorman's hands, and said, "Please give this to Meryl Marco," before they woke up. So the lesson there is, if somebody, you have to be ready to be lucky in the business, and if somebody expresses any interest at all in your material or in anything, don't keep them waiting. Hmm. Is the lesson. And I don't know if you'd agree, because there's another 20 writers in the waiting room.
See, the lesson I took from that was get a job at a video store.
Yes. Well, that's a different lesson.
The Misery Index premieres on TBS.
Yeah.
And you can still catch episodes of Monk.
Yeah,
all around
well, Monk
the world.
Is Monk's on. Monk is still alive and well.
You created Monk.
Yes, that's a whole other show.
That's a whole other show. The Good Cop is still playing on Netflix.
Good Cop. Yeah. What was your favorite episode of The Good Cop?
We can buy your toys. How?
Well, you can get my toys.
You have a new one.
I have
one
toys
with
in the store.
John Lovitz, right?
The John Lovitz doll will be in the store next year. The John Lovitz Little Diablo doll. That was on Kickstarter.
How's Rig Trivia selling? That's my
Rig
favorite.
Rig Trivia is fun. We're not pushing that. Maybe next year.
How do you know about that? Because I played it.
Oh, that's right. I guess I played it with you. Yeah.
What you have is this game that asks these really.
It looks like a genuine trivia question with hundreds of cards. But what your friends and opponents don't know is every card is, there's a key, in it, there's a code in every question that tells you
the answer.
The answer.
So you can play against like a six-year-old kid.
Yeah.
If
the kid knows the code, your six-year-old kid can never miss a question.
And how do you buy that?
Well, that will be available next year. We're working on that. That was an app for a while, but we're working on that.
Is there a website?
No, there's not, but it'll be in the store soon. I can't believe. When did you were at my house?
Your kids?
Oh, my kids showed it off.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
and
so
WFMU,
funny.
7 seconds.
Away. Every Wednesday at 6 o'clock on WFMU, I do what you do here.
Seven seconds only,
not as well.
I don't know about that.
Now, how would you say this conversation, this interview went?
Thank you, Andy Breckman.